ask the congregation to please stand at this time.
Amen and happy Sabbath, church. Come on, we can do better than that. Amen and happy Sabbath, church. Oh, welcome, welcome, welcome to this Resurrection Sabbath day. I'm excited for what this Sabbath symbolizes because we know that if Jesus did not get up from the grave, there would be no gathering like today. So I'm just excited that this is Resurrection Sabbath. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve, because he's the King above all kings and the Lord above all lords. He's the great I am. He's the beginning and the end. He's Alpha and Omega. Somebody give him some praise in the house on this Sabbath day. Somebody declare his goodness. Somebody declare his mercy. Somebody declare his everlasting love. For what a mighty God that you and I serve. Somebody say hallelujah. Amen and amen. I just want to say welcome, welcome, welcome to the Beacon Light Tabernacle Seventh-day Adventist Church. We are excited and happy to be in the presence of the Most High God every single Sabbath. We walk through these doors with thanksgiving in our hearts because we know God has spared our lives to see another day. I want to say warm welcome to all our members and to all our visitors and to all those who are watching virtually at this time. You are in the right place. And even as we worship God together, let us keep our focus on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I love you, and I'm excited that you have chosen to join us on today as we worship our Lord and our Savior. Please be seated in the presence of the Lord. And at this time, our clerk that is assigned for this Sabbath, Sister Nadia Morgan, will come forward to bring to us our announcements for this Sabbath. Blessings to each and every one of you. Amen.
Happy Sabbath. It's so good to see all of you here today. I hope you've had a wonderful week. I've had a wonderful week. I feel that any week that I walk with my Savior, trial or blessing, is a wonderful week. And every morning above ground is indeed a blessing, isn't it? Because the dead cannot praise him. So we're here today and we're going to praise him. I have an announcement. A few announcements before we head into our worship of our King. So I will begin this afternoon, with an announcement from our personal ministries leader, Elder Donald Allen. Next Sabbath, April 6th, there is a personal ministries team meeting after lunch. And the personal ministries team consists of all departmental leaders and elders. Let us remember that we have a work to do outside the walls of Beacon Light Tabernacle. So please be there, and thank you very much. Also on April 6th, from 5:30 to 7:30, the Education Department will host a Career Day seminar. Local business leaders will be on hand to provide the type of insider knowledge and guidance that will help you jumpstart your future. Invite your neighbors and friends to take advantage of this unique opportunity. I encourage that if you have any young people that are in college, who are in their senior years or heading into their senior years, that you encourage them to come to this. It's very important for them to understand the ins and outs and the workings of the job market. If you have any questions, please see Alicia Shand and Christine Sharp for more information. On April 13th, from 7:30 to 9 o'clock, is Beacon's 50th anniversary committee, and they're who are hosting a sip and paint. Channel your inner artist while you enjoy a smooth, satisfying glass of unfermented bubbly. You'll support the best of causes and leave with original pieces to adorn your walls. Kindly see the flyer in the bulletin for more details and register as soon as you will have time to purchase your equipment. Early registration is happening now for the prayer summit that will be hosted by the Hudson Valley Prayer Partners from April 19th through the 21st at Camp Victory Lake. For detailed information, please see the flyer in your bulletin or call Sister Jocelyn Blass. The Youth Ministries Department is planning an AYS social for April 27th after sunset. Our virtual spring revival series, Anchored in Christ, will be held at 7 to 8 p.m. nightly from April 28th through May 5th. Beacon Light Tabernacle, how do I love thee? Let me videotape the ways. Invitations to record a BLT tribute will be texted or emailed to you soon. You will have until the end of August to be shown to upload a videotape tribute about some features of Beacon Light Tabernacle that you adore. Your videos will be shown during our golden celebration, so start writing your script, rehearsing your lines, and see Sister McKinney for more information. The ushers department needs men, women, and youth volunteers to serve as ushers. Please see the bulletin for more information or contact Sister Maxine Allen. In 5.5 months, our Pathfinder Club will travel to Gillette, Wyoming to attend the International Pathfinder Camporee from August 5th through August 11th. There are several ways that you can help them bear the cost of travel, admission, equipment, and food. Number one, the G20 Baked Bread fundraiser is still going strong. The order forms, of course, are listed in prices and types of delicious homemade bread, and it's located on the top magazine rack in the foyer. Number two, you can use your tithe envelopes. You can place funds in them and write G20 on a blank line. If you're donating via Adventist Giving, look for the G20 section on the electric tithe envelope and enter your donation amount. And finally, you can also place a monetary gift into the hands of a guardian of a Camporee-bound Pathfinder. Kindly see Director Fordyce for more information, and let the Lord lead you forward from there. The Community Services Department distributes food and clothing on Tuesdays. Their new hours are from 12 to 7 p.m. For more information, please contact the Community Services Director, Sister Tanya Thomas. Beacon Light Tabernacle is big on prayer. We believe that the power of God manifests itself, or he just moves mightily when we lift up our voices to him, pleading in prayer and praise. So therefore, we have several ways in which you may join, so that where there's more than one of you, the Lord may answer. One of those ways is through the Hudson Valley Prayer Partners Daily Telephone Conference, which prays from Sunday through Friday morning from 5 to 7 a.m. Or the Northeastern Conference's Women's Ministries Department, which hosts Women on a Mission Together in Prayer on Zoom every Thursday from 5 to 6 a.m. The Wednesday night Zoom prayer meeting is held from 7 to 8:15. And this month, we are studying the book of Proverbs. And lastly, the Friday night children and young adult Zoom Bible study meets from 7:30 to 8:30. Please see your bulletins for more information and for the Zoom codes on how to enter the meetings. Our birthdays last week were on the 25th, we celebrated Shauna Pierre and Mary Robinson. And also yesterday, we celebrated Jesse Ogbuehi and my daughter Sarah Morgan yesterday. In closing, please, if you have not received or do not receive the bulletin, please contact one of our clerks. Give them your email address. Thank you. Give them your email address, and we will put you on the distribution list to receive the e-bulletin. And finally, when you visit Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, or such, please like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell so you will be alerted whenever new content is uploaded. Don't forget to share with others so that they too can be blessed. I hope you have a wonderful Sabbath as you prepare your hearts to worship the Lord Jesus today. Thank you.
Please stand for the call to worship. The call to worship is taken from Psalm 150. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. The church is now called to worship.
Above all kings, Lord above all lords, Father, we seek your presence even at this time. Father, we pray that you will come in our presence even on today, that not only would you show up, but you will show out, because you're an excellent, a mighty, and a marvelous God. Father, do what you do best. Work miracles in our midst even on today. And may the name of Jesus alone be magnified, glorified, and dignified in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hymn number 159, The Old Rugged Cross.
Far away, stood an old rugged cross. Sabbath. Children's story time, you guys, come on up. Have a seat. All the children of the world, red, brown, yellow, black, and white, all are precious in His sight. Jesus loves little children of the world. Amen. Happy Sabbath, boys and girls. Are you happy to be in church today? Yeah. I want to ask you a question. Why do we love God?
We love Him because He answers His prayers and our prayers, and He does miracles for us.
Amen, amen. Anybody else love God?
It's because He always forgives us.
Amen, amen.
It's because He gave us a family.
Amen, amen. Why do you love God?
Because He gives us health and strength.
Amen, amen. And why do you love God? Not sure? Okay, one more.
Because He died on the cross for us.
He died on the cross for us. Very good. I want to ask you guys, how would you feel if one day God was in heaven with all of the holy people in heaven and He said, "Have you thought about my servant?" And then He called your name. How would you feel if He started bragging about how much you love Him and how you're doing your best to show the world about His love? Would that make you feel good? It wouldn't make you feel good? You'd be embarrassed? Like, "Oh, shucks, God, really?" Right? You'd be a little embarrassed? One day, pay attention, the Bible says that God was in heaven and the devil went up to heaven and God was like, "Where have you been?" And he's like, "Oh, I was just walking around the earth, you know, going back and forth in there." And God said to the devil, "Hey, have you considered my servant Job?" You guys ever heard about Job?
Yeah.
Job was a man who loved God. And God said to the devil, "Hey, look at Job. He's the perfect example of a person who just is genuinely loving." And you know what the devil said to God? He said, "He doesn't love you. He's just happy because you blessed him. Look, he's wealthy, he has a family, he's got property, he's got a protection around him. You don't let anything bad happen to him. The only reason Job loves you is because you keep him safe and you bless him and you give him all these things. If you take that away from Job, he's gonna curse you and he's not gonna ever talk to you again." What do you think God said about that?
I think God said that he's a trustworthy.
He's trustworthy, very good. God said no. I think you're wrong. I think that Job genuinely loves me. So I'm going to tell you, you could take all his stuff away, but just don't hurt him. Don't kill him, right? Just don't kill him. And you know what the devil did? He said, "All right, we're going to have a test." Yeah? You know what happened? Okay, so we're going to go through the story. So in the story, the same day, Job was minding his business, and guess what? All of his oxes and his donkeys, they got stolen. All of his sheep, they got burned up in a fire, right? He had camels. Somebody came and took all his camels and killed all his servants. And then somebody came and said, "Oh, Job, I know you have 10 kids, right? But they were all at their big brother's house, and then a big wind came and it fell on the roof, and then the roof fell on the kids, and now all the kids are dead." Job, how do you think he felt?
Sad. In
despair.
Mad
at God.
Unhappy.
The Bible says Job tore his clothes and he shaved his head, right? And he said, "You know what? Glory be to God, because God gives us things and He could take them away too." And you know what? The devil was confused. He was like, "Well, I wasn't expecting that." So he went back to God and he said, "Well, I took his stuff away, but you didn't let me hurt him. So if you let me hurt him, then he'll curse you." And he gave Job big boils on his body, painful sores, right? It was very uncomfortable for Job. Do you think he cursed God then? He didn't. His wife did. His wife said, "Hey, Job, you must have done something wrong. So why don't you just curse God and die?" Do you think that made him feel good? That's not how you support people you love, right? It's not a good support, but you know what? Sometimes it's hard to watch people you love go through hard things. But the Bible says that no matter what happened to Job, he still praised God. Even when his friends started to say bad things about him, he did not say anything bad about God. And you know what happened to him in the end? God blessed him double for his trouble. Can you say double for my trouble? Double for his trouble. He had twice as many camels, twice as many ox, twice as many donkeys, twice as many camels, twice as many servants. And guess what? God gave him 10 more children. And the Bible says his daughters, he had 7 sons again and 3 other daughters. And the Bible says his daughters were the most beautiful daughters in the whole entire land. Everybody wanted to marry Job's daughters. And you know what Job did? Same thing he always did. He gave God glory and praise. So when you think about what God does for you, don't praise him just because he does stuff for you. Praise him because you genuinely love him and you are grateful that he is your friend and your God. Does that make sense? All right, so come, let's pray together. Anybody want to pray? All right, come on over. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes.
Dearly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for everything that you gave us. Thank you for a family that we all have. Thank you for the family loving all of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Who is next?
Dear Jesus, thank you for letting us be able to have church and help us to love what we have while we have it, and help us to keep our family close. But keep our friends close, but our family closer. And help us to be thankful for everything that you do for us every day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father God, I want to thank you for these little ones, and I ask that you keep your holy hedge of protection around them and everybody who you know loves you. Continue to help us to be who you want us to be and forgive us of our sins. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you, guys. You can go back to your seats now.
let's say worship the Lord. I worship him. Come on, he's brought you over some mountains. Come on, tell him thank you. Come on, tell him thank you. That's it, let's worship the Lord. He desires our praise tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. At this time, is here for the scripture reading. And the scripture reading is from Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2. May the congregation please rise as I read the word of God. And it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down on the right hand of the throne of God. May the Lord add his richest blessings to the reading of his most holy word.
Talk to our Heavenly Father. You know, the Bible says that we need to pray without ceasing. You know, when I think about that, God wants us to be in great communication with him always. All right, when you even driving along the highway, guess what? You can talk to God. When you're on the job and perhaps you are calling a meeting, you can take time and talk to God, because we need to acknowledge him in everything that we do. God wants to be ahead of your life. You know, some of us had a rough week. God said, all those who are labor and are heavy laden, he said, come unto me. That heavy load that you have, you can't deal with it. God said, bring it to him. Some of us had a difficult time. Perhaps you just want to come and say, thank you, Lord.
Yeah, so God.
Come in and say, thank you. That's what God wants from us.
Brother Gaither, we have you in our prayers. We understand that you lost your brother, and we have you and the family in our prayers. I want us to keep him in mind as well. So those of you who feel impressed by the Holy Spirit, please come. Please come. I'm asking all my prayer warriors, those of you who are prayer warriors and we believe that God will hear our cry, please come. Please come. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for being such a wonderful and an awesome God toward us. We want to thank you for your mercy, for your grace, and for your amazing love. God, without your mercy and your grace, where will we be? We thank you, Father, for giving us another chance, and another chance, and another chance, and another chance to get it right with you. Thank you, Father, for being long-suffering and patient with us, because we was once your enemies and died for us so we can have life and have it more abundantly. You also want to make sure that we make it into your soon-coming kingdom, Father. You made it all possible in sending the perfect Lamb, your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We want to just praise your holy name because you are so good and you are worthy to be praised. We thank you for bringing us here into your courts this morning. You said in your word, take the assembly of the brethren. We come in this fashion at your command, your instruction, Father, and we come for one purpose and one purpose only, to praise your holy name. Thank you for being so wonderful and good to us, Father. Thank you, God. I want to take time to pray for Brother Gaither, Father. He lost his brother. This is a difficult time, but he is here. In spite of, he's still praising you. I ask that you be with the family at this time. Be with them in a very special way. Some of us have come, Father, because we are heavy laden. We have so much and we can't deal with it, Father. And I'm asking right now that you would take it from us. And as you take it, help us to know that you are capable, and leave it with you. And we're going to leave. When we get out, we're not going to even think about it, because we know that you care for us and you got our backs. Thank you, God. I pray that your spirit would be all in this place, and that you would be with every aspect of the worship service, that Jesus would be glorified. Because once we glorify Jesus Christ, you would draw us all closer to you the way we came. Thank you for your goodness, Father. Thank you for your saving grace. Thank you for the plan of salvation. Thank you, Father. I pray, Father, that you be with the sick and the shut-in at this time. There are some folk who would love to be here, Father, but they cannot, but they had the opportunity to praise you from a distance online. Be with them, Father, because you can be with us and them and everybody all at the same time. You're such an amazing God. Be with those who may be in the hospital right now, Father. Be with them in a very special way. Let them know that you are with them, even though they're going through some stuff, that you are right there with them. You would never leave them. You would never forsake them, because you are a great Father and you love us so much. I pray, Father, that you will be with the young people of this church. Special way. They are young, have a lot of energy. I'm asking you, Father, that you do what is necessary to let them know that you want to use them, not just to save them, but you want to use them to be a blessing to others. Father, that any want to have his way with them as well. Help them not to be deceived by the glitter and the glamour of this world, but to stand firm on your holy word. Let them know that you have promises that you would never break. You love them. You die for them too. Help them at an early age to give their lives to you, Father, and to be on fire for you. Do not help them not to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. because you have called them to this ministry as well. Thank you. Help them to understand that our children we're talking about, Father, which is your children. You just blessed us with them. We have to raise them in the right way. But Father, they are in your hand now as we continue to do our part. I pray for our pastor, Pastor Ogbuehi. Father, you've just been blessing your manservant. And every time he come before your people, he do what you want him to do, to break the bread of life. The word of that he's been giving us, Father, since he's been here going on almost 2 years now, Father, you've been using him, and your word is so clear. I mean, we don't have no excuse if we decide not to follow you. I mean, every week you speak to us with power and clarity. We know that you love us, and you want us to be obedient to your every commandment and your laws and your statute, for this is the whole duty of man. Help us to understand that we not only surrender our lives to you so you can use us, but you want us to be a blessing to other folk we come in contact with. We got to be a part of the mission of winning souls to your soon coming kingdom. So I pray that you bless him today with a double portion of your Holy Spirit. Continue to be with his wife, Darlene, and their children in a very special way, Father. Please, Father, because the enemy don't like the fact that they want to be do a being about your business. So put a hedge around them, Father, and continue to bless them. And I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Father, again, I ask that your presence be felt and that we understand that we are not in our house, but we are in your house, and that we need to be reverent. Help us to be attentive. Help us to pay attention as you use the various ministries today, the music ministry, the reading of scripture, the hymn of praise, and the clothes. Help us to be attentive to you, Father, because you are talking to us right now. And we want to thank you for your goodness, Father. Help us to have a good time in you today, Father. And I thank you for all these blessings. In Jesus' name, let the church say amen.
To the King, I don't have much to bring. My heart.
Praise the Lord, church. Praise the Lord, church. If you're happy to be in the house of the Lord, can I get a hallelujah? Are my glasses only distracting you? You want me to take them off? I'm in mourning, so I'm like, I don't want y'all to see how puffy my eyes are. A lot of y'all don't know my brother McKinney and all the male chorus. They know my brother. And my brother passed away. And if anybody wants to come, it's on the 14th at Kingston 70 Minutes Church at 4 o'clock. And I wanted to thank those who blew up my social media, putting all those wonderful words of comfort. I don't know why this doesn't want to stay. Oh. But I just want to keep it at the throne. Is that all right? You know, it's so good when we're talking about how everything that Jesus did just so we can be with him, amen? He was broken so many times. He took all of our sins at once to the point where he sweat blood. And we can't even be gracefully broken. I can't even imagine what he went through just for me. Sorry, we got some little technical difficulties here. But, oh, there we go. So take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Oh, take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, oh, pouring life gracefully broken. Hallelujah. Oh, here I am, God, arms wide open. Hallelujah. Pouring out my life gracefully. Your mighty love stands
No more. invite the deacons to come, please come forward to collect the sporting tithes and offerings. The Bible is full of paradoxes and oxymorons, and the concept of giving tithe, as described in Malachi, is a perfect example, where it says that if you give, you'll somehow receive more. So as you give this morning, remember that you are not only obeying God, but God will come through with his promises and give you more. There are multiple ways to give besides coming to church to give. One of which ways is to go into the website, Adventist.org, and you follow along the electronic tithe envelope and give accordingly. You can also give through the church's website or Cash App, BLT, SDA. You can mail it in, or you can also put it in the box out front.
Sing the praises to our King, for He's the King of Kings. Give Him glory.
bring you all the tithes into the storehouse, so that they be meat in mine house. And prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you by the blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, your mercies, and all the blessings that you bestow upon us. We ask that you bless the tithe that was given today. And as we give of our blessings that you've given us throughout the week, throughout the month, throughout the years, that we would not only give with monetary gifts, but we would give of our time to you and everything that and the praise and all that is due to your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Hallelujah. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. Hallelujah. 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 He deserves all of our praise, all of our worship, all glory, all honor, because he's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If we can just worship on a corporate level on this afternoon, if we just give God some glory, amen.
My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. Belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it.
Lord, hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you.
Hallelujah. My hallelujah belongs to you. Because you thought that I was worthy. It wasn't. You gave your life for me. Was I worthy? Mm-mm. But you thought that I was. So, Lord, I thank you.
Yeah.
I praise you.
Uh-huh.
I adore you. I extol you. I magnify you, oh God. Because you thought of little old me.
You thought I was worth saving. So you came to my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I could tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving. Thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up.
So you cleaned me up inside.
You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free, so I can be whole, so I can tell everyone I know.
You thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping.
So you cleaned me up.
So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free, so I can be whole, so I can tell everyone. You thought I was worth keeping.
So you cleaned me up.
So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free, so I can be whole, so I can tell everyone I know.
You can. came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. You cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great, how great is our God. Can we tell him how great he is? Come on, help us sing, how great. How great is our God.
Is our God.
Sing with me.
Sing with me. How great
is our God.
Is our God.
And all the sea.
All the sea. How great.
How great.
Oh,
Everybody tired? Are you tired? Are y'all ready to put your hands together? Are you ready to shout? Are you ready to give God the glory? Amen. I have to commend your young people. I'm telling you, I play and sing at a lot of churches. Ain't no young people in there. Of course, there's young people in my church, amen. However, y'all have a lot of young people in your church, and you're keeping them busy for the Lord. And, you know, that first song that they danced on, oh my goodness, I'm so glad I had these glasses on. The tears was flowing. Oh my goodness. Keep training them up in the Lord. Hallelujah. And your reward will be so great. So great. Because even if they do leave, they will come back. Hallelujah. 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 And I, you know, we really have to trust in God, because hospice, you know, I ran out of money staying in hotels and renting cars and all that, and so I said, well, I gotta take a flight back home so I can make some money. I said, Reggie, I'll be right back. I gotta re-up. I got to the airplane and missed it, and they said that I couldn't leave the next flight. I don't know why people were traveling so much at that time. They said the next flight I can get was 2 days later. So I said, well, let me go back to his hospital bed. And, you know, I was all worried, but guess what? You know, somebody called me that owed me money from 15 years ago. Out of nowhere, it said, check your cash out. $100 or $200, you know. They sent me a few $100s. So I got a hotel and everything. I stayed a couple more days. I was fine. I went back to the airport to get on the next plane. I missed it again. Mind you, I had already believed that God was going to make a miracle and my mother was going to live and everything. And I was just confident. But God wouldn't let me leave. He said, go back to his bedside. So I went back to his bedside. We sang. Well, he couldn't sing. But, you know, every now and then he would say something. You know? Say he loved that song. He loved him some Larnell Harris. So I would sing and sing and sing. And money ran out again. out here. Ooh, glory. But guess what? All of a sudden, I thought I broke my wrist. I woke up, my wrist, I couldn't move it. I had to go to the hospital. They said, you didn't break anything, but you got tendonitis and all that. They wrapped me all up. So I said, well, I guess I can't play nowhere. The Lord said, go back to your brother's bedside. But guess what? The money still kept coming. Hallelujah. They booked me another 2 days. I went to go for the third time. I missed the flight. My bag was left at TSA and I couldn't find it. We had to get off the plane. Mind you, they put me in first class seating and I didn't pay for it. So you know I was mad. So I had to go look for my bag. By the time I got back to the plane, it was gone. And I was able to stay a few more days. But even in the few days that I was there, my brother said to me, he said, Marina, it's all right. I'm ready to go. So then I said, you know, well, Lord, it's in your hands. You have the final say. You have the final say, Lord. And I didn't miss the next flight. But he died a few days after that. So I'm at peace. He's not suffering anymore. Amen. Hallelujah. But don't we serve an amazing God? We have to be so obedient. You know, if I was just obedient from day one, my hand wouldn't have been all jacked up. We have to be obedient. We have to know when God is talking to us every single time. Hallelujah. So come on and put your hands together. I know we know that. Can y'all sing with me, please? Y'all want to sing with me? I know it was the blood.
Oh, Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm just going to slow it down just a tiny bit. Hallelujah. Because what manner of love is this that a man will lay down his life just for me? Just for me. Just for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. and tell him how much you love him now. Tell him how much you love him.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Because I know I'm not worthy. But you did it.
For me.
Just for me.
Come on, give the Lord another hearty amen. Just for me. Jesus did it. Just for me. Thank you so much, Sister Marina Clooney. Thank you so much for blessing our lives and letting God use you in such a powerful way on this Sabbath afternoon. And I just want to thank all our worship participants, for those who participated with the various aspects of this worship experience. Thank you so much to Adoration. Say amen, somebody. Thank you to True Worship. Amen. Thank you to New Devotion and all those who participated in this worship experience on this resurrection of Sabbath. The God we serve is a good God, and he did not have to die, but he chose to die for your sins and my sins, that we may have eternal life with Jesus. If there's any reason to shout, it's because Jesus died and Jesus got up on the third day, and that's the reason why you and I are in here today. All because of Jesus. Are you with me, somebody? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And hallelujah. And I have to thank God's hands, next generation. Amen. That was powerful. Amen. That was very powerful. Thank you to all the young ladies for that praise, dance, demonstration, ministration. It ministered to my heart, and I'm sure it ministered to you also. And thank you, Jesse, for carrying the cross. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for carrying that cross, and that was great. That was great. He gets it from his daddy. He gets it from his father. Strong like his dad. Amen. And amen. And amen. Please stand with me as I read our scriptural consideration for this morning. I will not be too long, but there is a word from the Lord on this resurrection Sabbath. Our scripture reading which was read beautifully by Sister Barbara Kilchrist, is Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2. Hebrews 12 and verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher or perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. If you give me your undivided attention, I'll bring to you this afternoon a message I have titled Mission Accomplished. Mission Accomplished. God, we thank you. We thank you, and we thank you for your marvelous grace that cannot be quantified, neither qualified, because our minds cannot comprehend the depths of your love. But all we can say is thank you. Therefore, oh God, that which you have in store for us on today, speak through me, that I and your people will be edified. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated in the wonderful presence of the Most High God. Jesus is on a mission. Not an easy mission, but a divine mission. He is born in a humble setting in Bethlehem and raised in Nazareth in Galilee. At the tender age of 12 years old, Jesus astonishes the teachers of his day with his wisdom and understanding. He is, without a doubt, the greatest and most compassionate teacher that this world has ever seen. When he speaks, people listen. When he speaks, even his haters gather to hear the words that proceed out of his mouth. This Jesus is a walking and talking miracle. At a feast, he turns water into wine. At another gathering, he takes 5 loaves and 2 fish, and he has the greatest all-you-can-eat fish and bread buffet the world has ever seen. There is something about this Jesus. As Jesus walks the streets, blind eyes begin to see, the lame begin to walk, the dead come back to life, tax collectors become his followers. Even a young boy is brought to life in the middle of a funeral procession. A woman with an issue of blood touches the hem of his garment and she is healed. Another woman at a well is immensely blessed, so much so that she becomes an evangelist as she begins to proclaim, "Come see a man who told me all things that I have ever done. Could this be the Christ?" Church, we need more people like this woman that can proclaim to a dying world, "Come see a man who healed my body. Come see a man who turned my life around." We need more evangelists that will spread the good news of Jesus and testify, "Come see a man." This man, Jesus, is simply amazing. Jesus is on a mission, and his mission does not end with restoring eyes, restoring ears, restoring limbs, or even restoring hearts. Jesus, he must restore the very soul of humanity. His purpose on earth is to die so that humanity can be redeemed from the darkness that has ensnared it. Jesus is on a mission. And at the culmination of his time on earth, we see Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane with his disciples. The text says, as he retreats to pray, he takes only his inner circle, Peter, James, and John, with him, and he tells the other disciples to go and sit. At this historical juncture, the text says, Jesus is sorrowful and deeply distressed. He tells his disciples, church, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. He says, stay here and watch with me. Jesus experienced deep sorrow like no other person has and will ever experience. Church, sin is extremely heavy. Sin is heavier than anything you can think about. You see, the heaviest material on earth is a metal known as osmium. If you gather all the osmium in this world and multiply it by a trillion and weigh the osmium, it will pale in comparison to the weight of sin. Church, sin is extremely heavy. Are you still with me? And the reality of what Jesus is about to experience, bearing the sins of everyone who ever lived up to the time he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and for everyone who will live after this point in history, it weighs on Jesus deeply. Consider this, church. The current population of the world is about 8 billion people. So just imagine how many people lived prior to our time and how many people will live after our time if Jesus tarries. The entire weight of sin for all these individuals, including your sin and my sin, is laid upon one person, Jesus. Sin is heavy. You see, this reality of the weight of sin that he has to bear brings about a clash between his humanity and his divinity. So much so that he falls on his face. Jesus literally falls on his face and he prays, oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. So feeling the heaviness from the weight of sin, his humanity is displayed when he says, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. But immediately his divinity kicks in and he says, not as I will, but as you will. So I don't know about you, but I thank God for that 12-letter word, nevertheless, that changed my life. Because if it was not for nevertheless, I would still be in my sin. If it was not for the word nevertheless, I would still be a candidate. candidate for hell. If it was not for the word, nevertheless, there will be no hope for my tomorrow. If not for the word, nevertheless, heaven will be off limits for me. If not for the word, nevertheless, there will be no redemption for my sins. If not for the word, nevertheless, there will be no reunion where I will see my loved ones, my younger brother, my grandparents, my close friends. Thank God for the word, nevertheless. I just thank God for that 12-letter word that has changed our lives eternally. Thank God that Jesus did not quit. But even as his humanity kicked in, Jesus says, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Jesus did not quit on us. That is why the author of Hebrews pens, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy, there's something about joy that was set before him. He endured the cross, despised the shame, and he has sat down at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. The text says the reason why Jesus endured the cross was because of the joy that was set before him. In other words, on the other side of his suffering, there is something that Jesus sees that delights his heart, that makes him keep on pushing. There is something at the other side of the cross that Jesus holds on to that gives him joy even when he's dying. What was that joy? It cannot be the pearly gates in heaven. Why? Because Jesus had already been through those gates. What is that joy? It cannot be the heavenly streets paved with gold. Jesus had already been on those streets. What is that joy? It cannot be the beauty of the angelic host singing harmoniously in the presence of God. Jesus had already experienced it. So what was the joy that made him endure the cross and despise the shame? It was the joy of seeing you and I saved, delivered, and dwelling in his kingdom. Jesus saw me. Jesus saw you. Jesus saw us, and because of the joy that you don't have to die and go to hell, he was so excited that he kept on persevering. He kept on pushing. He did not give up because you are the joy that Jesus saw. He saw me. He saw you. And the Bible says because of that joy, he endured the cross. Marvelous grace of our loving God. Grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was split. Somebody said grace. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within, grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sins, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through his infinite mercies, his child, and forever I am. You see, if Satan knew what God was orchestrating through the death and resurrection of Jesus, he would have done all he could to stop the plan of redemption. So while the devil thinks he's winning, he's actually playing into God's hands. The devil stirs up greed in Judas' heart so that he betrays Jesus. But hold on. God is on a mission. For if Judas does not betray Jesus, Jesus is never committed to a trial. Satan causes the Jews to despise Jesus so much so that they pick Barabbas over Jesus and ask for Jesus to be crucified. But hold on, God is still on a mission. For if Barabbas was not condemned and Jesus was set free, Jesus would never have been sentenced to die by crucifixion. The devil stirs up the people to beat Jesus and force him to bear his own cross, the cross in which he will be hung on. But hold on, God is still on a mission, because unbeknownst to the devil, it was necessary for Jesus to die on a tree. For in the beginning, the fruit that hung on a tree and looked pleasurable in the eyes of man brought death to humanity. But now that which is about to be hung on another tree and looks despicable brings life to humanity. The first tree represents death, but the second tree represents life. Jesus is stripped and hung between two criminals to the devil. He is definitely winning this one, because the imagery of Jesus hanging between two convicted criminals places him in the same category of these convicted individuals. But hold on, God is still on a mission, because it was necessary for Jesus to die between these two criminals, because while Jesus is dying, I mean he is dying, his kidneys are failing, his liver is failing, his brain function is failing, one of the criminals leans to him and says, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus stops dying. Jesus turns around and says, "Behold, assuredly I say unto you, today you shall be with me in paradise." So even when Jesus is dying, he's still saving souls. So it was necessary for Jesus to die between two criminals. Are you still with me, somebody? Jesus' place between this man was God's orchestration, because somebody, while he was on the cross, needed to receive the good news of salvation. Are you still with me, somebody? When Jesus dies and is buried, Satan rejoices, because lying in a tomb, he sees a dead Jesus. The one who wreaked havoc to his kingdom is no more. The devil and his demons must have thrown an all-night party. But hold on, God is still on a mission, because early, Sunday morning, while the devil and his angels are celebrating and rejoicing and giving themselves high five, Jesus gets up. He shakes off death. He shakes off defeat. He has the keys of life and death. And he has a new title. His new title is Resurrection and the Life. He has a new title. He has a new vigor. Death could not hold him down. The grave could not keep him in. The stone the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. The devil gets an L, but Jesus gets the victory. Mission accomplished. Having disarmed principalities and powers, Jesus makes a public display of every devil. Mission accomplished. For what the enemy meant for evil, God turned it around for his good. Mission accomplished. And without great controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up in glory. mission accomplished. For if God be for me, who can be against me? Mission accomplished. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God will raise a standard against him. Mission accomplished. For I am more than a conqueror through Christ who loved me. Mission accomplished. For eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man, the good things, the beautiful things, the awesome things, the lovely things, the powerful things, the great things, the marvelous things that my God has in store for me. Mission accomplished. For many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers from all. Mission accomplished. For in a little while, he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Mission accomplished. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying. There shall be no more pain. For the former things have passed away. You're going to see your son. You're going to see your mother. You're going to see your brother. You're going to see your husband. You're going to see your friends. For the time shall come when the dead in Christ shall rise. Because mission accomplished. Jesus paid it all. Jesus paid it all. Jesus paid it all. You're going to see your uncle. You're going to see your auntie. You're going to see your brother. You're going to see your loved one. Because the time shall come when the dead in Christ shall rise. Mission accomplished. Jesus, receive the glory. Receive the praise. Receive the honor. Say hallelujah, somebody. Say hallelujah, somebody. Say hallelujah. Mission accomplished. Jesus is Lord. There is no one like Jesus. There's no name greater than the name of Jesus. For it's at the name of Jesus that every knee bows. Is at the name of Jesus that every tongue confesses. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. There's only one that has the title. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. So if you want to live again, come to Jesus. Because Jesus is the only one that guarantees eternal life. He's the only one that can boldly declare, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man, no woman, no boy, no girl can come to the Father except by Jesus. Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know him? New devotion will come right now for our appeal song. Amen.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sin
stand in the presence of Almighty God. Jesus offers his blood freely to each and every one of us. It will be something that words cannot express. If Jesus went all the way for you and I, and the gift of salvation is a gift, it's free, but we reject this gift, and at the culmination of Earth's history, you find yourself lost because all you had to do was say yes to Jesus. Is there anybody in here that wants to say on this Sabbath afternoon, yes to Jesus? Is there anybody in here, you've never made this commitment to go with Jesus all the way, to surrender your life and be baptized, an outward expression of the inward conviction you receive in your heart, but you want to say on this Sabbath day, past on this resurrection Sabbath 2024, I'm going to make a public declaration. I want to be baptized. Or that you've been baptized, but you've strayed away, and you know it deep in your heart, you're not living your life the way you ought to live. On this resurrection Sabbath, you want to make a decision for Jesus. Just raise your hand. Salvation is a personal thing. It has nothing to do with who is to your right or to your left. And as I always say, if you don't have the boldness to do it here, pull me to the side, talk to me, and I'm willing and happy to study God's word with you. Is there anybody here that wants to say on this resurrection Sabbath, Father, I want to live a purposeful life. For Jesus, you died for me, that I may live a life pleasing unto you. But you just want to make a commitment to God by raising your hand to say, I want to make a declaration not to be baptized because you've been baptized, but I want to make a declaration that from today, I'm going to walk with new purpose. From today, I'm going to walk with a deeper recognition of what Jesus did for me. Just raise your hand. I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. Lord, you see the hands of your sons and daughters that are saying today, God, I want to walk with a sense of new purpose. I want to walk with a new sense of assurance that Jesus died for me. And because of the joy he had me in his mind, Jesus saw a picture of me and says, no, I'm not going to quit on Uber. Jesus saw a picture of you and the joy that one day we will all be reunited together kept him going. Thank you, oh God, for the 12-letter word, nevertheless, that saved our lives. For if Jesus had turned back, we will be dead in our iniquities. But thank God, there was joy, and there was joy that kept him going. Bless us once, bless us twice, bless us eternally, and may Jesus and Jesus alone be magnified. Amen. Amen.
Our closing hymn this afternoon is hymn number 86, How Great Thou Art. We'll sing the first and the last stanzas.
Announcements before I share the benediction. We have lunch served for everyone, so please join us in the fellowship hall, please, for lunch. Right across the doors, there's a meal prepared for all of us as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If you are blocking someone, please don't leave. Just move your car. If somebody wants to go out, you can move your car to the grass, but please come back in and let us fellowship as we eat. Let us share testimonies of what God has done for us. This is an opportunity for us to fellowship even as we share a meal together. Let us bow our heads for our benediction. Father, we just thank you for blessing us today in every aspect of our worship experience. Father, I pray even as we are about to partake of a meal that has been prepared for us, we pray that you bless and sanctify the meal. Let it nourish our bodies. Let us have a great time as we fellowship amongst ourselves. We pray that your grace, your mercies, your love, and your kindness will continuously be upon us. Let us continuously reflect on the death and resurrection of Jesus. Thank you, O God. We are grateful for your grace and grateful for your mercies. We say receive all the glory and praise. Bless us. Bless us, bless us. In Jesus' name, amen.